to still the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man who calmed the sea.
My favorite part of the morning right there. Walk out of the house, sun's coming up. Beautiful sunrise over the golden harvested fields of the Brown Farm. Wonder if Adam's awake but yet. I doubt it. Every morning, I got the fuel trailer. I'm usually the first guy that shows up to the field because I usually grease the combine once or twice a week. They say every 50 hours, but we usually do every 20. So that's every 2 days-ish, somewhere in there, give or take. Oh. Blow out all of the filters because it's dusty this year. It's really bad this year. So we're in a major drought and this is the fun part right here. This is how I get my workout every day. Up, down, in the cab, out the cab, across the field, in the truck, up the bend, down the bend. All that dirt that was in here, that's the cab filter. So if that wasn't there, that'd be all in the cab and the combine. And it's amazing what these things will do for you. Fuel the combine up. I know what you guys are all thinking. Man, look at that fuel trailer. I tell you what, some of these fuel trailers, I mean, we use them a month out of the year, and brand new ones are like 25, 30,000 plus. It's ridiculous. So I just made my own up. And we had this little skid loader trailer, and I just threw a tank on it, put a little box in the front. Does the same job for a lot less money. Let's do all that. Usually Dad, Chad, and sometimes Adam will show up. And then the day starts. So we'll head out to the field and try to combine some corn today.
Here we are once again in the old tractor.
I got Adam in my buddy seat again.
Yeah, I'm pretty much worthless out here. Most years when it's not a drought, I'm out here running the truck, but we don't need two semis. We only need one because you needed to water your corn, pal.
I know, I didn't turn the sprinklers on enough this year. Well, I prayed for it, but it just didn't come.
Yeah, so that's all we do is pray for rain, pretty much, so.
Which, didn't get it this year.
Yeah, sometimes you get it, sometimes you don't.
Yep.
The Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away.
That's right, amen.
But it makes you appreciate the good times. If life was all just roses and daisies, we'd all be a bunch of spoiled babies.
That's right.
And farmers are definitely not spoiled babies because it's tough out here.
Oh, it's, yeah, so tough.
In this air-conditioned cab.
Yeah.
With a, do you have a fridge in here?
No, Dad's got a fridge in the combine, though.
See you later. And here we go, folks. We're off to the races. We got the truck going. I mean, the tractor going.
Come experience the Browns Century Theater in Lamar's, the ice cream capital of the world. The Browns share a variety of live music shows throughout the year, showcasing their talents in concert. To start the day, come early for a made-from-scratch Iowa cooking buffet at the beautifully restored Central Event Center. Then save time to shop the fabulous selection of gifts, decor, chocolates, candy, and more. Enjoy a dinner and theater experience at the Browns Century Theater in Lamar's, Iowa.
Well, today on Mick's Kitchen, I will be making crayon apple maple pork chops. It is a wonderful fall dish that has a little bit of great Iowa pork and some maple syrup, so that sweet flavor with some apples, perfect for this time of year. So let's get started. I've got a big skillet here, and we're going to start on high because we're going to boil the cranberry juice, 1 cup of cranberry juice, and 1/3 cup of maple syrup. So we're gonna pour that into the pan. A little sweet, a little sour. And once this heats up, we'll add our pork chops. And I have 6 thick cut pork chops, about 1 inch, maybe a little more. So as that heats up, I'm gonna add the pork chops one at a time. All right, so we're gonna boil those. And once it gets boiling, then we're going to turn it down and let it simmer for about 15 minutes. So we can see we're getting close to the boiling point. I'm gonna let it go a little bit more just so it's really cooking. We want that outside seared really nice on the pork chops and to incorporate all that good flavor. Oh, ooh, you can really smell that maple syrup. This is gonna be a great dish. All right, I think we're at the boiling point, so now I'm gonna turn my heat down to medium, and we're just gonna let that simmer and cook while we cut up our apples. 2 apples that we're gonna peel and cut. Now, I think I might peel one and leave one unpeeled, and then we'll just slice them both. That way we have a little variety because the peel is fine if we want it, but I know some people don't, so we'll do a little for each. Leaving some of the peel on the apples will also add some more nice color to the dish. Now that the apples are all cut, it's maybe been about half of the time, 6 or 7 minutes. So we're gonna flip the pork chops once during that 15 minute period. So I think I'm gonna turn the heat up just a little bit more, simmering nice. So if you use your smaller, thinner pork chops, just adjust the time accordingly so we don't get them too tough and too overdone. But these are pretty thick, so we might be going a little longer than 15 minutes. All right, so we'll flip those and keep them simmering. And now is the waiting game. Our liquid is cooking down a little bit, and it's been about 15, 16 minutes, and so we're gonna add our apples. So those start to tenderize and cook. So I'm just gonna add these over the top, get them in some of the juice. And a little stray guy there. And now I'm gonna bring my heat up a little bit more to a medium to high heat, and we're gonna get it boiling again. Although it's simmering pretty good here. So we just want these apples to tenderize for a little while here and pick up some of the flavor of that syrup and cranberries. All right, we'll give this just a few minutes. When the apples start to tenderize, we're ready to go. So give it a few more minutes here, let it cook down. Okay, I'm just gonna double check the temperature of the pork chops to make sure we are good to go, just because they were a little thicker. The pork chops have a good internal temperature, so we're ready to go. What I like about this is you can just take it right in the skillet and put it on the table on a hot pad and serve it as is, or you can move it to another platter. That's fine too. But I have some craisins here, some dried cranberries. And so to add just a little more color and flavor, I'm just gonna sprinkle some of these over the top and Oh, see, I love the color contrast there. That makes your dish just look really nice. Maybe one more handful. Yeah, just a few. I think it is a beautiful dish, perfect for a fall gathering or a family meal. Now is the time where you get to try one. I'm gonna turn it down a little bit so it stops cooking. And let's add one to the plate here. Let's grab an apple or two. It's just a little one. Some of that good juice, pour that over the top. All right, let's cut in and try it. It's usually pretty hot. Get a little apple here, a little cranberry, gotta have it all together. Really delicious. That maple syrup, you can definitely taste the flavor. Such a beautiful complement to the pork chop. And the apples, can't go wrong. Cranberries, I love it. All good things fall. So I hope you'll enjoy this recipe. Try it at home. Let me know if you try it. I would love to hear about it.
Check out more of Michaela's recipes in her cookbooks, Stage to the Stove, Brownielicious, and Seasons. Easy and hearty recipes for everyday cooking at home for family and friends.
You know, this song reminds me of a story that happened just a few weeks ago. I was walking with my grandson on a Sunday morning into church, and we were in a huge parking lot. And so I was being cautious, and I said, "Here, take my hand." Well, he held it and we walked across the parking lot and went across the crosswalk, went into the entryway and greeted people at the church, and then walked into the foyer, and pretty soon he let go of my hand. And that reminded me of another time, a long time ago, when my youngest son, Andrew, the baby of the family, well, he used to like to hold my hand and I loved to hold his. So we were in a big department store and we rode up the escalator, and when we got to the top, he let go of my hand and he said, "Mom, I'm not gonna hold your hand anymore, but when you're old and 80, I'll hold it again." Well, that was a sweet moment and a memory that I'll never forget. But you know, for many, many years, I've been holding on to my Savior's hand. And the one thing about holding hands is you have to be going in the same direction. It's pretty hard to hold hands with somebody going in opposite directions. In fact, it's impossible. And I'm thankful that when he reached out his hand, I put my hand in his nail-scarred hand, and trusted in him and all that he had done for me on that cross. And you know, I intend upon holding his hand all the way through this life as he leads me to my heavenly home someday. I hope that you can say that. I know that he's always waiting there for you to put your hand in his hand.
Mama taught me how to pray before I reach the age of 7. When I'm down on my knees, it's when I'm closest to heaven. Daddy lived his life with 4 kids and a wife. Will you do what you must do? But he showed me enough of what it takes to get me through. Put your hand in the hand of the man who stilled the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man who calmed the sea. Take a look at yourself and you can look at others differently. But putting your hand in the hand of the man. family. Every time I look into the holy book, I wanna tremble. When I read about the part where the carpenter cleared the temple. For the buyers and the sellers were no different fellas than what I profess to be. And it causes me shame to know I'm not the man that I should be. Put your hand in the hand of a man who stilled the water. Put your hand in the hand of a man who calmed the sea. Take a look at yourself, and you can look at others differently. But put your hand in the hand of a man from Galilee. Put your hand in the hand of a man who stilled the water. Put your hand in the hand of a man who calmed the sea. Take a look at yourself, and you can look at others differently. But put in your hand in the hand of a man from Galilee. Put in your hand in the hand of a man from Galilee. Oh yeah.
Are you enjoying the music on Hometown with the Browns? These songs and more are available on our website, thebrownsmusic.com. Or you can stream them on all the digital platforms. Uplifting music to encourage you through your day.
We have been in a miserable drought all year. And started 5 months ago planting this crop. We knew it was dry. But we planted, always hoping for the best. And we got some rain, but certainly not near enough. You can see some of this corn. A lot of those stalks don't even have an ear on it. But we got to get what's there, and so that's what we're doing. Farmers always say there's always next year.
I think, you know, people ask us a lot of questions about farming and stuff, but the number one question I get from mechanics that come out here, other truck drivers, other farmers, how big is that grain cart?
I'll tell you how
grain,
big it is.
Okay, people call it different.
It's huge.
Grain wagon, grain cart. So this grain cart is probably, it's bigger than your average grain cart. They don't make them this big.
It's as big as a house.
It's massive. But our uncle owns the company, Balzer Manufacturing.
Shout out.
Shout out. And my cousin, our cousin is, what is he, like head of sales or something?
I don't know.
I forget. He's high up in the company. And so they bring us down a grain cart. Usually to test them out and stuff, but we've had this one for quite a while.
How many bushels officially
well,
is this grain cart?
2,150 bushels. Roughly, I would say 2,000 bushel. What's, you got a calculator?
No, I got a calculator.
What's 2,150 times 56?
120,400.
So that's how many pounds this grain cart can hold, roughly, give or take.
That's a lot of pounds, man.
That's a lot
that's
of
a
corn.
That's a lot of corn.
A lot of corn.
It's a lot of corn flakes. So when are we gonna get auto steer out here so I can take a nap?
Well, they do have, what is it, amphibious? Is that what you call it, unmanned, amphibious?
Yeah, something like that. Campbell's tractor.
Yeah.
Well, it's hard to trust technology.
Chris, heck,
you
I mess up.
You gotta get used to it.
I mess up all the time, so I should have a computer.
You gotta get used to it. You gotta get used to it.
Yep.
What's that old song? I love technology. Not as much as
you and me.
UIC.
Oh, I thought it's you and me.
Yeah. Come on, Wafonda.
Wafonda.
Quote that movie. Name that movie. Comment below if you know that movie.
This is going in bin 8, right? Or 4, right?
Yep. Did it work all right?
I do have an off button somewhere here.
I'm talking like a minion.
Yeah, we're good. All right.
Sorry, Chad. Driving truck, he's the man. They're used to my nonsense.
Ow! Let me know if you want me to be hit back. Put another headed door and stuff on the go. I'm just kind of combining the back here. Kind of opening stuff up a little bit here.
10-4, good buddy.
Breaker, breaker. Breaker, breaker, 1-9 combine. Breaker, breaker, 1-9 combine.
I don't know what he's saying.
That's the key word there.
That's Adam. We just ignore what he says. This the check?
No, little to the left.
See, there you go. There you go. I just ignore it. I just ignore it.
Is it hot? Scarf. Is it hot in here?
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, I'm gonna drive now. Let's go. Come on. Get out of it. Get out of that seat.
Whoa! It's beeping. It's beeping. All right, I got my phone over there. What is that? All right.
Whoa. How fast can we get this going here?
Dude, easy!
Woo! Dude, hey, where am I going?
You gotta turn around and go back.
You got this big a track, you might as well let it rip. See that little truck right there?
Dude, you can't turn this sharp.
I bet I could drive right over it.
Oh boy, this
there goes a fence.
I think this is the first time I've ever sat in this buddy seat.
Buddy, he's a real buddy.
Can you hand me my coffee?
Which one? it's empty. Oh, this one?
No.
Seems a little cold. Oh, I don't want to jackknife it here.
Yeah, Dad jackknifed it the other day.
Did he really?
Yep.
Woo! I wonder if I can ramp that terrace. You ever seen a four-wheel drive tractor airborne?
We should try that sometime.
I'm not going to lie. This thing is intimidating in a good way. Like, I'm not scared to drive it, but you're up here and you're like, I feel like
it's
the top of the
world. It's a big momper.
Oh, sorry. Well, I'll tell you what. Harvest is the best. A lot of folks ask, what do you like better? Planting season or harvesting?
You know, I was talking to Dad about this the other day, actually. And I think, personally, some people, I'm going to get hate mail for this. Or I'm just going to get an email. But I think I like plant. I like.
We get a lot of emails.
Yeah, we do.
You should have said that.
You can't say that.
Well,
they're all the emails.
We did.
All the emails are from Michaela.
Pretty much.
You boys, you have too much fun.
I would say that I like planting better than harvest.
What?
I know.
Dude.
I think it's
man.
Because here's the thing, I do all the main, pretty much all the mains. You know, I have to clean out all the air filters. You know, fuel everything up in the harvest time. But in planting season, I fill up one tractor, I put seed in it, I go out and plant. I'm by myself, nothing else. When you're harvesting, it's combines, tractors,
that's
trucks.
True.
You gotta have more people, you gotta have,
you're
you
know, loading in the grain bins.
You're loading into this, you know.
Nothing like harvest time. That's kind of the final reward of all the work. And of course, for us, it's also very enjoyable, but it's a business, it's our livelihood. It's what pays the bills, so you like to reap the bountiful harvest. No farmer doesn't like harvest. Sometimes it gets a little long and drawn out, but it seems like whenever we're done with the last field, it's like, I wouldn't mind having another one to go do.
Harvest. You can't get Dad out of that combine. Nothing gets Dad out of that combine. Well, there's been a few things.
Football.
But yeah, even then, corn, when we're combining corn, I'll start the combine up maybe in the morning, do a little bit. Dad's out there right away. I think he can sense in his sleep when that combine starts.
Oh, really?
I mean,
hey, how's my driving so far?
It's a little bumpy, but we'll blame that on the planter.
I'm usually 80% of the time in one of the semis, which is kind of fun because then you can stop at the gas station and get candy and pop.
I tell you what.
All the snacks you want. Out here, you're stuck, man.
It used to be.
Nobody cares about
the gas station in Merrill used to be the spot.
The concept is the same. You rip off an ear and send it in and run it through a big something that's spinning, the little holes, and the kernels throw all through. That concept is similar, but all way bigger. First combine I ran when I was in probably junior high and high school was a two-row combine, a little bitty narrow machine, and took two rows, and we were just amazed that we were actually shelling the crop, not picking it in the ear. And they've just grown and grown as the years have gone, and now here we're running a 12-row, and there are bigger ones than that. They make 16 rows, but it's amazed me in my lifetime how things have changed. I can't imagine with Andrew being 26 years old what he'll see in his 45 years of farming like myself, I can remember years back, my father was coming down with Alzheimer's. We had just gotten a larger combine, and I was tickled pink when I got him in the machine one day, and his mind was pretty sharp that day. And the amazement when he looked down at those eight rows, he was talking a little bit like I am now. He says, "I can't believe how big this is." And one of my great memories of my dad of all his life is kind of being able to show him a little bit that how it's changed from when he started till now. So,
oh, good.
Ready to hit. Don't fall back.
10-4. Good buddy.
10-4, good buddy. Breaker,
breaker. Breaker, breaker one, man.
See, you got to get the lingo while you're out here. I've been out of the game for a while, so I got to brush up on my CB talk.
That's always the worst. Something breaks or something, you're like,
ooh, I don't want to turn too sharp.
Dad, right. You got a copy? Yeah, what's wrong?
My favorite part here is getting after the combine when he's ready to dump. Oh, he's not ready to dump. But I'm right there, ready.
Oh, yeah, we know you are all ready to go. He's probably going to wait till after that washout.
Yeah, you're probably right.
Oop, or not.
Let's go.
This is going to be fun.
Here we go, baby. Go, go.
Ooh, watch it.
We love to dump on the go. I'm a sister. See, when he goes down in a gully, the tractor goes one way, combo, and goes the other. You got to be careful you don't hit the big old, what do you call it? Auger.
Auger, yeah, that's auger. What those are called. I tell you what, I should have had you come out this morning nice and early and wipe off all the windshields for us.
What a rip, baby! Here we go. Now we're talking.
Dumping on the go.
This is a farmer's dream right here. Taking in 12 rows, dumping into the big grain cart. Aw, man. Life, I'll tell you something. I had a terrible day the other day.
You did?
You guys called me out. Drive the tractor for 2 hours. I'm like, I don't have time for that, blah, blah, blah. But I went out anyways. What are you going to tell Dad? No?
Yeah.
No. So I came out, got in the tractor. Dude, my day turned around.
Really?
100%.
Aw, that's so nice.
I've had that happen more in my life than not. So Getting out here, it'll clear your mind.
Hey, don't stop. Okay. Keep going.
Don't?
Keep going.
Dude,
he'll hit his auger. He'll hit his auger.
Oh. We're clear, man. I got it.
I've done that a time or two.
In the park. And that's how it's done.
And now you get on Facebook and wait.
It's just like riding a bike. Kind of all comes back to you.
Browns.com. Experience Main Street Lamar's and browse the gift shop. Located next to the Brown Century Theater, you'll find a beautiful and unique collection of home decor, gifts, gourmet food, chocolates, and local Midwest items. The Candy Loft has something sweet for the kids, and leave room for chocolate truffles, caramels, clusters, turtles, and more. The Browns Theater Gift Shop, located on Main Street Lamar's, open Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and on theater show days.
Passing it on. Passing it on.
To stay up to date with all of our episodes, like and subscribe to our channel. And if you want to hit that little bell button, you can be notified every time a new episode drops. Thanks for watching Hometown with the Browns.